Welcome to the show, Luigi Denorio De Mayo, Head of Dev Relations and DeFi at Ava Labs.
Hey, Patrick. Nice to be here with you.
Awesome. Glad we can get you on. I think this is going to be a really popular one. Today, we're just going to talk about Luigi's background, Avalanche, of course, and then what's going on with DeFi and on-chain finance on the Avalanche network. Luigi, to start, do you think you could share a little bit about yourself for the viewers?
Sure. So out of school, I went to school for finance, bachelor degree. Right out of school, I worked at Citigroup over in Tribeca, held multiple different roles there. I started out more on the operational side of things for anybody who's worked in TradFi. And so I think that's sort of where my love for blockchains come, understanding how things work, how they settle, how value is traded, et cetera. I eventually moved to the trading desk. I traded a few different products. I traded CDX, which is an index of credit default swaps, IG and high yield. And I also traded equities thereafter. So had about a 7-year run, 6 or 7 year run at Citigroup. When my daughter was born, I was kind of like just not really feeling that lifestyle very much at that point. And I left to go work in consulting with the idea that I would actually get more involved in crypto. So it was around 2016. At that time, I actually conceived the idea for a startup. This is like pre-ICO craze. At that time, I was going to a lot of Ethereum meetups. I was pretty involved in that community. And I actually raised money for a startup called Proof in around that time, and it was basically like a way to sort of incentivize people to find out, well, vote on misinformation online and online content. So it was an interesting protocol way too early, but we raised money, we built it for a few years. I think that's where I really learned deeply about, like, you know, mechanism design, tokenomics, basically what it takes to build something in blockchain and Web3, and then ultimately like learned a lot about blockchains, because fundamentally I was consistently thinking about the trade-off of what can I and what should I put on chain, because it was expensive. So that was that endeavor. When DeFi started to really bubble up, like early, maybe like mid 2019 or so, I got pretty involved there, because just naturally my background as a trader and also somebody who was just involved and excited by crypto and building products, like that was something I did. So I played a lot. I played around a lot with DeFi summer and thereafter. And then, Avalanche had an opportunity to sort of lead their DeFi efforts, and I joined early 2021. And after that, one of the first things I realized after I joined was like, wow, this is, and everybody has to remember, this is pre L2s. I was like, wow, this is a really fast chain. And, we should be able to get all DeFi applications to launch here, and people should be really happy about how cheap and fast it is. And so we devised the Avalanche Rush program, got that off the ground, were able to recruit and get over a bunch of like the Ethereum OGs, and then, have our own protocols build, our own developers build. Earlier this year, I took over like the DevRel side of things and building out a number of different items like the Avalanche Academy, which is a way for people to like sort of learn about different items they can build on Avalanche and, develop. And then Codebase, which is our new program, which we're really excited about, which is sort of like a Y Combinator for Web3, and effectively allows, like, it provides you a stipend if you're approved, and you can go build out a really cool product. So that's something we're really excited about as well. But yeah, that's basically my story. I first started with Bitcoin in 2011 on the trading desk. I was trading it. Yeah, I bought it really early. I sold it too early. I still have the Coinbase prints on the account, and it's every once in a while it's pretty depressing to go look at them. But I was also like playing, there were like restaurants where you would get points in Bitcoin back then and all these kind of stuff. And yeah, I sold Bitcoin when Apple Pay came out. I thought the thesis was over. And so I eventually came back, of course, but it just goes to show how much has changed in terms of the thesis over time. Everybody was looking at it like electronic cash back then. And then after the whole Mt. Gox debacle, it seemed like there was a lot of issues to figure out. And I was right for a while, but then, yeah, obviously it came back with a vengeance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, that's always funny when people say, you know, I wish I'd bought in 2011. I have lots of friends who bought in 2011, 2012. Most of them sold.
Yeah, I sold.
Early, right? And then either got back in later or never did. Funny story, what you mentioned about how fast Avalanche was. I actually made a YouTube channel because of Avalanche. Because 2021, I was trying to get my dad into DeFi, and he tried using Ethereum, and it was, you know, it's like, I'm not spending $40 on a transaction, right? As someone who had never used crypto before, he said that's, you know, he wasn't going to do it. So I tried Avalanche. I said, hey, you know, this chain feels just like Ethereum. You can use the same wallet, but it's cheaper. And so back then, it was before you could withdraw directly to the C chain from exchanges. So you had to withdraw to the X chain and then bridge it over in the Avalanche wallet. And he couldn't figure it out, and I couldn't find a video to send him. So I recorded a video. So that was my first video on the channel, was how to bridge from X chain to C chain.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Yeah. And so then I checked back, you know, I just recorded it and left it. And then, a month later I checked back and it had like 500 views, and I was like, oh man, for me, that was a lot at the time. I said, oh man, you know, I could probably make more videos like this. So I just started doing, more tutorials, and that's how I came to spend 14 hours a day in crypto.
14, that's it?
depending on the day, you know.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's cool. I mean, like, you know, it's always interesting meeting the people who were there early versus the ones who are not, in terms of Avalanche, because the ones who were there early remember the narrative at the time and like how exciting it was, you know, to use a chain where you click the button and like the transaction was done. And, you know, that was real, like, on-chain L1 transaction. So, you know, I think it's pretty cool. It showed what the tech can do. And then, you know, we have a lot more in our roadmap to show, like, you know, that was, like, basically a use case for us. Like, here's what you can do with the EVM. But, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, great transition. And by the way, we had a Fish from Trader Joe on the channel last week. Nice. But, yeah, so great transition to talk about Avalanche. Before we get into Avalanche specifically, high level DeFi, what do you think the greatest challenges in DeFi are right now? And this is actually a question from Twitter.
Yeah, great question. DeFi faces a lot of challenges, to be honest. It's sort of in this adolescence stage where, you know, early on it got some adoption on the completely permissionless side. You know, but to get to the other side of, you know, to become an adult, it will need to, you know, it will need to be somehow either regulated or, you know, basically out of the like scope of non-regulation, right? So it's in this weird spot where, you know, I talk to people all the time. They don't want to build products. They don't want to put their name on products. Like, ultimately, the growth is capped out of DeFi until, you know, people feel comfortable building and deploying products with their own name in any jurisdiction. Until that can happen, it'll be very difficult to actually like see the best and brightest building. With that said, like, you know, and I've said this for a while, I think like there's going to be two forms of DeFi. I think there's going to be the completely permissionless side of DeFi that will always persist. As long as you have an internet connection, you can, you know, use various public goods, so to speak. And I think that'll continue. But then I think there's going to be another side. I don't really call it DeFi. We call it on-chain finance. And this will be like, rather than using Coinbase, Binance, you know, Ameritrade, all these types of things, there'll be blockchain-based applications. You know, they'll still have KYC. They'll still have all the things that you do normally, but they'll be run with blockchain rails, which will give you faster settlement, more transparency, all this type of stuff. So I think there's two paths, and like both will persist. It remains to be seen, like, you know, which direction the world will like ultimately lean towards. But yeah, I do think that the greatest challenge for DeFi right now is the regulatory stuff.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know, I've heard that sentiment before, and I've, you know, that's sort of sentiment I've expressed as well, that it's going to bifurcate, but people who try to go, you know, toe the line might have a tougher challenge. But how do you see those two worlds interacting in the future? Or do you think that they'll be completely segmented?
So I could see them interacting in a way where an asset is issued on a completely permissionless chain, but in order for people to do like some interesting things with it, they'll have to be, you know, they'll have to ensure there's KYC and all this other kind of stuff. So that's kind of how I see it playing. Like the asset can sit on a public permissionless blockchain, but for people to be able to maybe take custody of it, borrow against it, at that point in time, that might be where the KYC will be mandated. Or, you know, ultimately, we live in a world where the whole law, all the legal structure is created where it's based on intermediaries. And this space is based on no intermediaries, right? And so, you know, it's going to take a whole host of time to square that circle, because it's a fundamental change of the way we do things and the way all of our like legal structure has been created.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. And so a common criticism I hear is people say, if there's going to be this on-chain finance, then there won't be permissionless DeFi. What would you say to that?
I don't believe that. I think, you know, there'll always be applications, you know, that are run. I think it's hard to shut them down, frankly, like all of them. And, you know, as long as like you can create new front ends and stuff like that, I just don't know what the overall adoption will be, frankly. Mm-hmm. If they really do, you know, if regulators really do crack down on that, then ultimately, you know, some users might be apprehensive, and then, you know, people might be apprehensive to run the UIs. Like, I don't know how much I believe in that, like, that mantra that, like, you know, well, anybody can host the UI. If that's the case, that's fine. Like, I could use the product, but how much liquidity is it going to get? Like, how usable will it be? And can I really trust that the UI will always be there? You know, like, it's not a, like, sometimes I feel like we solve for worst case scenarios, but we don't solve for, like, you know, building a unicorn. And the unicorn will not, you know, work in a world where regulators say, like, this is just not okay. So that's kind of the challenge there.
Yeah, kind of like people who, you know, people host their own website and servers in their basement in 2022. Yeah. Like, you can do it. You can do it. It's just not
the norm. Yeah, I don't want to do it.
Yeah. No. Awesome. So change of topic. Why Avalanche? I mean, you mentioned fast, cheaper, but I know Avalanche can do a lot more than that with subnets. So what makes Avalanche unique?
That's a good question. Avalanche has got an interest. Avalanche fits in an interesting place. You know, it brought to market a really unique consensus mechanism, which is the reason that, you know, you were able to do those super fast transactions. And, you know, it happened so fast. That was just a complete scientific breakthrough. On top of that, it's also brought to market an architecture which allows for people to build their own blockchains. So, you know, from that perspective, it, I think, will fit in its own category of, hey, if I want my own blockchain, or I want my own app chain, or whatever you want to call it, sovereign chain, Avalanche is going to be the fastest and best way to do that. And I think that's where it's going to play. And then naturally, the primary network and the C chain will reap all the benefits from that. That'll be the liquidity hub. Like, it's something different than Cosmos, where Cosmos didn't really start with a hub. You know, there are many Cosmos zones still vying to become the hub, whereas Avalanche, like, we sort of started with it, and all the exchange integrations, all the Oracle feeds, all like sort of just the blocking and tackling soup and nuts are already there. And then, you know, we have this protocol called Avalanche Board Messaging, AWM, which allows you to communicate with all the subnets. And so the ultimate goal for us is to have a bunch of sovereign blockchains that feel like one. that's the goal. That's what we're trying to build. We have many different efforts right now from the technical side on why we're trying to, on items that we're trying to build that get us there. But that's ultimately the focus. That's what we're doing. And so for me, I fundamentally believe that you will need, you know, partitions in block space. And if that's the case, then I don't see many architectures out there that allow for this. Like, you could build your, you know, an app chain on an L2, but there are certain, you know, limitations to doing that. Like, you know, you inherit some of the fee variability of the L1. And I just don't think that's going to be tolerable for app chains. So for me, it was the consensus, strong community. And, you know, I think the tech is top notch.
Awesome. I want to dive into subnets a little, because there might be people watching who aren't familiar. What would be an example of a subnet application?
Sure. So there's a few subnets on mainnet right now. One of them is Dexalot. Dexalot is like a central limit order book exchange. So if anybody remembers Serum, or you could think about the experience you have at Binance, but it's on its own app chain. It's completely decentralized. So you can go there, you could trade spot assets with an order book on its own chain. Now, that wouldn't be possible to do on the C chain. Fees would be way too high. There would be much different MEV games that would be played. Frankly, they wouldn't be able to build their own sort of like economy. And so now they're able to use their own token as gas, they're able to accrue value back to their token. And, you know, users get this really seamless experience. And the cool thing is, like, the way that they built it is, you know, when you're on the C chain, you're actually able to transact on the subnet without switching networks. So they're making the user experience a little bit cleaner as well. That's one example of a subnet. And then we have like a bunch of institutional enterprise efforts. And then, you know, one of the other big verticals is gaming. So that's one where subnets really is getting a lot of adoption. A lot of people are excited about a game called Shrapnel. That should be launching quite soon. There's a TSM subnet coming with their Blitz app. Godzilla is like one of the games that many people are very excited about. Like, these are all subnets that are launching quite soon.
That's interesting. Yeah, one thing I've always found interesting about Avalanche is, I mean, I know you guys have a ton going on, but it's got like the super institutional adoption play on one side. Then also, it's probably one of the, if not the top chain for gaming applications right now on the other side, which to me are similar in that they're bringing real world use, but also very, very different.
Yeah. I mean, I think ultimately, you know, we looked at the architecture as something like AWS. You know, AWS doesn't limit itself to like, hey, this is only good for gaming. You know, it's good for a lot of different verticals. And, you know, we built, I think, quite, you know, a pretty strong team that's gone out there and attacked a bunch of verticals. You know, Ed Chang leads our gaming efforts. He's formerly from EA. He's done a great job bringing, big titles at Avalanche and taking a Web3 lens at it. Morgan Krupetsky, who I work with at Citi, is leading our institutional efforts. And, you know, as you saw with the recent efforts we did with JP Morgan Citigroup and a bunch of other throughout the year, like that's paying dividends. And there's a bunch of other verticals that we're also attacking on the enterprise side and also on the permissionless side. So we're pretty excited about that stuff.
Awesome. Now, if you know off the top of your head, how many subnets are on mainnet right now?
I would say like 20 maybe. And 20? Maybe like 130 on the testnet.
Oh, wow. Okay. I was going to ask how many.
Yeah. And to be clear, not everything that's on testnet will ultimately get to mainnet, but you know, we've certainly seen a lot of momentum there. And there are a lot of subnets that are looking to launch. For example, like I know Hubble's launching their subnet soon. That'll be a perp mm-hmm. DEX. And like I mentioned, a bunch of the gaming ones. There's some mm-hmm. other on timeline as well.
Awesome. So, you know, usually on this channel, a lot of times we'll talk into the specifics of how to use DeFi in different chains. So if a DeFi user wanted to look at Avalanche right now, let's say they've never used it before, although I think most people who have been around for a few years have probably touched it at some point, but yeah. Let's say they've never used it before, what should they check out?
Yeah, I mean, I'm probably going to forget somebody, but, you know, there's a lot of interesting applications. You know, I mentioned Dexalot. That's one people should check out. It's a cool product to trade. They have the simple swap built on the application, like I said, so you can trade right from the C chain. There's other products like Trader Joe's Liquidity Book, which I find to be a really cool product. It has a fantastic UI for concentrated liquidity DEX. It allows you to like easily scale in and out of positions, and you get paid fees to do so. There's other products like Struct Finance, which tranches yields across different types of, like basically they did GLP where they tranched the yield into a fixed and floating product, which is really cool. So you were like getting 8% fixed rate on Bitcoin, for example, BTCB. But now they're integrating Trader Joe auto pools. And so they're going to give you a fixed yield on an asset and a variable yield. So I think that'll be cool. That should be launching soon. Delta Prime, really cool product that allows, you know, sort of like Gearbox, where you have this like prime brokerage type of environment where you can borrow, I think, 1 to 5x against the assets that are listed there. That's a really cool product. There's GoGo Pool is an interesting product that a lot of people are getting excited about right now. They have this one-click launch your own Avalanche validator node. It's similar to like something like a Rocket Pool. But, you know, if you stake some of their token, you're able to get higher yields. Like, you know, people were saying they were getting somewhere between like 30 to 70% on Avox with the one-click mini pool. So that's an interesting one to take a look at. Banky's obviously a homegrown project that's done really well on the lending side of things, but they also have a liquid stake token called SFOX. That's on, you know, all, that's basically integrated everywhere throughout the ecosystem, and that's really exciting. We obviously have like perp DEXs like GMX and some other ones. So I keep going, but there's a good amount of products to check out. I just suggest people going to like DeFi Llama and going through them one by one, or checking out your threads or other people's threads.
Awesome. Yeah. No, we definitely have an update coming on Avalanche DeFi in the channel soon. But yeah, I always tell people if they don't know where to start, just go to the DeFi Llama page and look at the top ones. And
yeah, those guys
there's a lot to work with. Awesome. So question we had from Twitter, I guess from a developer, wanted to know if there's any grants or program to help DeFi projects on other chains that might be interested in migrating to Avalanche.
Yeah. You know, the Avalanche Foundation is consistently giving out grants. It has a general grants program, but also we also have an investment fund via Blizzard, which also invests in projects. We also have a number of incentive programs. Avalanche Rush is still an active program. Avalanche Multiverse for subnets. We are looking to also bring on some more community-oriented grant programs, which is just like allow community to vote for different grants. So hopefully that comes in the near future, but in the meantime, people could reach out to anybody at Ava Labs or, submit a grant application as well. And then, as I mentioned, we also have Codebase, which is an accelerator program, $50,000 stipend to build sort of your dream project for 3 months. Now, there's not a bunch of spots. It's going to be highly curated, each cohort, 2 cohorts a year. But the goal there is to, like, find the best founders and the next best projects to work through.
Awesome. Yeah, I think great opportunity for the right people. Cool. Any things in the pipeline for Avalanche DeFi that you're excited about right now that you can share?
Yeah, there's a few things I can't share. The Stake Hut guys have a pretty cool update coming in the next few weeks, which I'm excited about. There's a few protocols that should be launching next year, which are, I think, are like, they actually bring new things to DeFi that never existed before. Can't really mention too much about what they are, but just keep your eyes out for that. I'm also super excited about the intersection of DeFi and like other verticals, like social, sharing economy type of applications that could be built. And I think there's a real opportunity in crypto. People just bucket things into like DeFi, NFTs, gaming, but like there's a whole nother like area that's not necessarily being, I feel like not enough people are building on. We'll be throwing a hackathon, early January just for this vertical, with some pretty large prizes. But, you know, I want to see people building decentralized Yelp. I want to see them building decentralized sharing economy applications. So I think
marketplace.
Yeah, marketplaces. I think there's a really huge opportunity for that right now, and I think the tech is good enough at this point.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's, when you say it, right, it's surprising that there's not a credible decentralized Uber.
Well, yeah, I mean, we were talking about this stuff in 2016, but we were early. I was early. We were early. I think now, like, you're starting to see stuff like Hivemapper and this and these like DeepIn projects. So I think this is like starting, like the ball starting to roll. And like, you know, if I was building something, I would be building something in those verticals.
That's interesting. Yeah, that was actually one of my questions, was if you were starting something today, what you would start.
Yeah, man, I don't know. Like these, like something like, I say decentralized Yelp. I don't mean like just taking it and decentralizing it. Like there are super interesting things that I think Friendtech and Stars Arena and all these applications taught us in terms of ways to get the network effects and get adoption quite quickly, and also to improve the UX of crypto, but you know, in a more sustainable way. So I'd love to see much more experimentation on that side of things, because fundamentally, like all, you know, what all these protocols have in common is like, not protocols, these applications of Web2, is that the users are sort of exploited for all their data. Like they are the ones that created the network, but they are not a stakeholder in the network. So I think that's what crypto can change. They can change who the stakeholders are, and the users get rewarded for contributing to a network. So I think it makes a lot of sense. It's like something we've heard a lot, hasn't happened. So we get a lot of eye rolls when we talk about it. But I think like a few, you know, if you find the right founders, they'll be able to sort of, you know, organize and build the right thing.
Incredible. Some other questions. One, what advice would you give yourself from 5 years ago?
Oh man. 5 years ago, I probably would have other than put all my money in crypto, no. I don't know. I guess I would just say like I should have gone 5 years ago. I should have just like dove in a little bit deeper. I was pretty deep in DeFi, but like I still had a full-time job outside of it. You know, I would have just liked to have done it full-time at that point.
Nice. It's weird because I was thinking my answer now is very different from what it would have been 2 years ago, because 5 years ago now is the top of 2017 bull run, right?
Oh, what would I tell myself? Top of,
That's not even what I meant, but like I'm realizing that now because my
answer. I did that one pretty well, so I didn't get too hurt there, but I don't know. I thought that was really obvious at the time. Yeah. Like all the ICOs felt like, you know, there was nothing really happening for a while. Like it felt like there was no reason for it to go up anymore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. My answer was always senior year of college. I had a friend who, it was a PhD in comp sci, and he had a friend who was starting a hedge fund for crypto. This was 2015. And he said, oh, you know, they're looking to make one of their first hires, or were you interested? And I was like, nah, you know, like, I don't really want to get involved in that. And that was always my answer was, you know, that was massive bag fumble. But
for sure.
10 years ago, almost.
My bag fumble was in like 2011 or 2012. That was my
favorite. Awesome. Yeah. So we put out questions on Twitter, as you know. I think I got 4 or 5 questions about your cooking skills, culinary skills, I should say. So I feel like I have to ask something about that.
I post pictures
about your pizza making abilities.
I post pictures of my pizza making. I'm improving. Bought a nice wood burning oven outside that I like to make pizzas. Cooking calms me. I find that it's like, you know, quite an enjoyable activity. I really like to know what's in my food and stuff like that. So, I make a lot of things. I make, you know, different pastas, different soups, a lot of lentils lately I like. But yeah, my pizza is quite pure. Mm-hmm.
I want to hone in on that. My dad and I built a brick oven pizza in his backyard.
Oh, nice.
So we've made... a couple of weeks ago, we had people over and made about 80 or 90 pizzas.
Wow, that's a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot, but you know, it's a whole, you know.
So. No, I mean, they cook in a minute. Your internet.
They cook in a minute. Yeah. So is yours wood fired?
Yeah.
You said wood fired. What temperature do you like to cook at?
900.
900. Nice. Nice. Yeah.
Yeah, I make sure like I have like the volcanic bricks on it.
Yeah.
And they like get hot but not too hot, and they like cook. They cook. It cooks the pie in about a minute, and the crust.
Any specialty pizzas you make that you would have a tough time finding elsewhere?
There's like there's this one pizza I make with like it's like red chilies and like a smoked mozzarella.
Mm-hmm.
That's a really good pie. It's simple, but it's it's spicy, but with the smoked mozzarella, it gives it like a nice flavor. That's one you don't usually find at restaurants or anything, but it's really good. I make a pretty good pesto pie.
Mm-hmm.
That's a solid one. I'm not one for diversity. I really like standard pie. I like a nice margarita,
mm-hmm.
Buffalo mozzarella, basil. We make our own sauce once a year.
So nice, nice.
Pure about our stuff here,
Yeah, yeah. Well, I was going to say, you probably know this already, but if you don't, let you know a secret. So my parents have a farm in South Jersey.
I'm in New Jersey as well.
Yeah, so they have a farm in South Jersey, but you probably know this part, that there's many heritage Italian farms in South Jersey. And
yes.
A lot of them have heritage breeds of tomatoes that you can't find in the grocery store. So maybe you source your tomatoes from there, but we've been doing that a lot.
We do. Very we always good. Get the crates in end of August.
Mm-hmm.
I make sauce for the whole year. I think nice. I posted a few pictures of it one of the years on Twitter. People got a kick out of it.
Yeah, no, I know we're getting off the topic of DeFi, but last year my dad went crazy with getting seeds for all these different heritage tomatoes, and then we had, like just went crazy. Some were better than others.
Tomatoes are good.
Jersey purple tomatoes, green tomatoes. Yeah, it was pretty fun.
That's awesome.
All right, so that's the background behind your cooking. Other fun question from Twitter was why Pokemon?
It's a good question, man. It became an inside joke. I mean, first of all, I loved Pokemon as a kid. I still think back of like, I don't know if you'll remember this. You're probably younger. Going to school with my Game Boy and like the wire and like plugging into somebody else's Game Boy and like having a live fight. But think about how long ago that was. Like, that was pretty damn advanced at the time. Like we were like having a live match,
Yeah, no, I am old enough to remember that. And you're right. That was, 20, 25 years ago at this point?
Yeah.
I mean,
peer-to-peer games right there. It was pretty cool.
Way to level up your champ.
Yeah. I mean, we have inside joke at Ava Labs. We have, a chat. They're Pokemon-themed chats. I sort of asked everybody to put Pokemon PFPs up because somehow, some way, I want to meme a Pokemon subnet into existence. And I figured, one of the things that at least I could do is eventually if they decide to go Web3, they're gonna be like, all right, we might as well use the guys who have all Pokemon PFPs on there. So it just kind of like stuck. And then, I never really got off of it. I just like Pikachu.
Nice, nice. Who doesn't? Final question. A lot of people I know, especially as the market does better, are interested in pivoting from Web2 to Web3. What advice would you give them?
Yeah, I would just say dive right in, go all in, do not pass go. Like there is, people get super scared. If you were somebody who believes in themselves and actually, put in the work, you'll find that you'll make money in this space. You'll make a name for yourself. It's a very small space. It's not hard to stand out, in my opinion. The talent level is not as high as it should be. And, if you are talented, you are hardworking, you will come in here and you will, you'll own an area of the space. It's also super interesting. Like, there's not a day that goes by when I'm not like, somehow, some way captivated
mm-hmm.
by something I've either learned or heard or working on. So, I don't know. I just feel like especially I tell young people all the time, I talk to universities and stuff, and to me, it's a no-brainer. Like, they're always like, tell me about, working at the bank, and, I really want to go do that and whatnot. I'm like, that's fine. Like, you can do that job. It's a fine way to start your career and, learn some things for sure. But, don't do that. you know, you're gonna like postpone your life effectively. I think there's, you know, so many more opportunities out there in this space that, you know, and across verticals, developers, business people, marketing people, across the board, like there's careers to be made, and you'll be able to sort of like jump the ladder much faster if you're good in this space.
Awesome. I'd love to leave it on a positive note. Thanks so much for joining, Luigi.
Thank you.
Any parting words you want to share with the audience?
I just hope everybody has a good holiday season. You know, I think there's a lot of interesting things to check out on Avalanche. Send me a DM if you have any questions. I try to respond to them all. So, yeah, that's it.
Awesome.
Awesome, man. Thanks for the time.
Thank you.